Everybody who decided to tune in for the live show, and those of you who will watch later in the VOD, thank you for tuning in. I appreciate it. Welcome to Course Correction Episode 4, which is chock full of all kinds of space information. So, it's a lot of text and a lot of talk in tonight's show. Not as much video as we did last week. Obviously, we did like 40 minutes of video with not a lot out of me except kind of commenting on things here or there. Tonight will be different than that. It's been a busy week in space news land. Today was a busy day in space news land, so much so that I was making changes to what I was presenting up until about 20 minutes ago. So I see somebody in chat, and I'm gonna push the mic to the side here for a second. I want to show them something cool from 3D printer land. Check this out. Can't really see it, but that is the moon, 3D printed, with a light inside, and it's awesome. I have too many toys, but that one's a cool one. So anyway, thanks for being here tonight, guys. We will get started here, so let's go into what we're going to talk about tonight. We are talking about... I'm talking about getting those red boxes off the screen is what we're talking about.
These pandas are here to party.
Need more cool toys? Indeed. I mean, realistically, I do, but I think you get that off there. So we're going to talk about last week, Mike Pence made a speech and set a bunch of lofty goals, and we're going to do a reality check on that, simply put. There was also something else that bugged me last week, believe it or not. Spacewalk 53, we're going to talk about what they did and some of the dumbness around how the world reacted to certain things. India blew up a satellite last week. We'll talk about that. The Rocket Lab's R3-D2 rocket finally took off. We have a video of that. During Mango Plays Games stream about a week and a half ago, she was playing Satisfactory, and the topic of space elevators comes up because there are space elevators in that game, and we decided it would make something cool to talk about. And then in the past week, NASA has pivoted again on SLS used with Orion, and then they did it again. We'll give you an update on Beresheet. We'll talk about Hayabusa as well. We'll cover some upcoming launches, especially this week. The next show will not happen until after Falcon Heavy. We'll get into a little bit of that and what's going on with Falcon Heavy this week. So yeah, those of you here again, thank you for being here. Let's get into it. So last week,
get good.
I'm trying to talk. Sorry. Last week, there was...
What's happening, hot stuff?
Told you I had to change it, Doc, or Dustin. So, last week, Space Council meets, and as a part of that meeting, the Vice President got up on stage and gave a speech in which he shifted or accelerated... Yeah, easier to have that as a team.
Put that cookie down.
Hi, Leech. Hi, Riot. Glad you're both here. So during the speech, Vice President Pence decided that he was going to effectively say, we're not gonna go to the moon by 2028. He said, you guys need to get your butts in gear and by all means necessary, get to the moon by 2024. He also went into how NASA should potentially rely on commercial spacecraft to get us there, and how if a contractor's not performing, you should switch. Well, that's what the speech was. Let's start with that last point. Switch contractors in a 5-year span. Engineering a flight to the moon. Grumman was behind schedule by almost 9 months on delivery of the first LEM to NASA, and instead of dropping the contractor, NASA rotated missions so that Apollo 8 went to the moon around Christmas, and then LEM 1 flew on Apollo 9. It's not as easy as the Vice President thinks to simply switch contractors in the middle of engineering, because you effectively aren't gaining time, you're losing time. You would have to go relatively back to the drawing board in order to say, oh, these guys aren't doing it fast enough, let's go to someone else, give them less time to come up with something from scratch. But let's get into reality on this speech. This is NASA. Their percentage of the total federal budget and it's been in a steady rate of decline for many years. See if you guys can pick out where Apollo is on that, by the way. I'll give you a hint. It's on the left. But this is intended to provide you with the frame of reference for the next several points. You see the curve as we get towards current time. You see that, yes, there's a blip in there around 2008 where it went up. But over time, since 1991, it's effectively a sliding curve down as a percentage of overall federal budget. Now, that's not to mean, that's not to say they didn't get more money than the previous year in any of those years. But as we provide NASA with less and less overall of what we take in as a government. So NASA's working with less all the time. This is actually important for several different parts of tonight's show when we get into Spacewalk 53 as well. But this is important. This is what I always talk about. Fund NASA before you tell NASA to do things. So I'm not picking just on Pence. I am picking on Pence, but his speech specifically. But the past several administrations, both parties have made these really ambitious speeches about going to beyond low Earth orbit. And each time, President Bush said we should be on Mars by 2015, if you remember. But they've all said, let's do this amazing goal, which effectively was an applause line. And then none of them have given, obviously based on the previous graph, the necessary funding. No one's funding NASA. No one is giving them the money they need to do the things they're being mandated to do. So even if this lunar return was feasible by 2024, as it stands today, there's not funding for it. And more importantly, there's absolutely, at current levels of funding, not enough money to do it and Lunar Gateway. You just can't do either together without an increase in NASA's budget. Because Lunar Gateway is been on track for a long time. And it's not something that someone can simply stand on stage and say, let's change now. There's an international group that's working on it together. And Mike Pence effectively got on stage and said, you know, the hell with that. We're going to go forward with my accelerated political goal. And that's really what it turned out to be. It's motivated in part because China is starting to flex its muscles in space. But it's problematic to simply get on stage and say, let's do this now, when not even 2 weeks ago, when the White House budget proposal was released, NASA was moon by 2028. They had fancy videos and everything. I mean, it's a huge just whiplash on when will we go to the moon. I think 2028's ambitious. I'll tell you this much. I don't think 2024 is possible. So in the days after this Penn speech, Bridenstine met with NASA employees in town hall meetings. He did so again today, and we'll get to that later because it's a different point. There were about 90 or so questions he took from across multiple NASA sites. And the questions he received and answered focused on not without significant increase to funds. Well, I still don't think it's possible from an engineering perspective, but the questions that Bridenstine took focused on three areas. One, and you can see this is from the social QA, and I didn't put a question in. I didn't vote on any questions, but I did log in because I wanted to see what they were asking, and so did other journalists. I'm not like sneaking into the NASA town hall or anything like that. But these were the questions in terms of votes that were addressed during the town hall because the people that work at NASA wanted to hear about them. Will the administration and Congress back up this audacious goal with an appropriate influx of funding? I mean, no, not if you look at the budget proposal, they won't. 1B, SLS 1B's cut if the White House has its way. How do you get to the moon with the European service module if you cut 1B? The second one, like I just said, accelerating our return to the moon is an unfunded mandate. How do we do it without gutting other missions? Medium-sized science missions are already in jeopardy. We've done 5 major medium science missions since 1990 in space. We have backshelved major scientific probes for the ever-shifting goals of large spaceflight objectives and small craft like rovers. Yeah, that seems ridiculous indeed, Dustin. It is. Please explain. This is also a quote from the speech. We will change the agency, not the mission. It doesn't have any sort of background when what Pence said. He said, we will change the agency, not the mission. So, I mean, what does that mean? They're gutting NASA to go commercial and form public-private partnerships? There's nothing there. He said all this stuff, these quotes, these sound bites, as Dustin says in chat. But there's nothing there to suggest that this is possible or that they actually have any sort of structured plan. Apart from, I wanted to make a speech, I wanted that speech to make headlines, and then everyone else figure it out. Vice President Pence directed us to land a crew on the moon within the next 5 years, quote, by any means necessary, unquote. What means will you be using? Now, I don't agree with that at all. We don't sacrifice safety, we don't sacrifice efficiency, and we don't sacrifice every other thing we're doing. I mean, I'm not willing to sacrifice Gateway to be on the moon by 2024 because it gets us nowhere. If we go to the moon, put boots on the ground, we have effectively replicated Apollo. We may learn a few things new, but there is much more from the perspective of moving us further away from Earth in exploration of space from a crewed spaceflight perspective if we build a Gateway. We learn how to make reusable landing craft. We learn how to support a station that is not a four orbit around Earth flight away from rescue. We would do none of those things if we sacrifice Gateway to facilitate a 2024 goal. And there are problems with that 2024 goal. Pence talked about landing on the South Pole of the moon as the target. We, as of today, do not have the necessary communications infrastructure to maintain continuous contact with any astronauts who would land there. So again, are we going to live with the idea that we can't continuously talk to those astronauts? Or is that one of those by any means necessary, where they're in a place that's never really been gone to before from a lunar perspective, and we're comfortable with the idea of being out of contact with them for periods of time? We don't need to do it that way. That's stupid. We can definitely deploy the necessary structure, given enough time and money, to never ever lose contact with those astronauts. And then Pence further outlined a reliance upon harvesting oxygen from material found at the lunar South Pole for the purposes of on-site production of return trip fuel. There's no such technology that does that today. So he's suggesting that we build that technology in the next 5 years, test certify it, and deploy it to the moon with crew for the first time, hoping it gets them home. Gemini was built to prove the functions of Apollo. Everything they did in Gemini, from docking with the Agena to docking two-man spacecraft to spacewalking, all of that was designed to build a skill set that NASA could say, we know how to do this, we've done it repetitively, we've simulated it and simulated it and simulated it, and now we've gone and done it in an environment where it is safe, where we can get those astronauts out of danger if we needed to, with an acceptable risk at the time to human life. What Pence is suggesting is potentially stranding astronauts on the moon, hoping that the technology can be done, because it won't be tested thoroughly enough in 5 years. Bottom line is Vice President Pence is out of touch with scientific reality. He denies climate change is real. He denies that evolution is real. And he promotes intelligent design. And he has continuously, as a legislator, voted against energy efficiency. I'm not being political. Those are facts. And space flight and exploration is science. If you're not in touch with scientific realities, I don't think you're in a position to stand in front of a scientific council and set goals for it. I believe that makes you unqualified. At the end of the day, he only learned of the 2028 target that NASA had 5 minutes before he got on stage. That's from the Washington Post. They reported that this week, that Mike Pence stood up on stage in front of the National Science Council and said, I want to put you guys should meet on the moon in 5 years. But he had no idea that a week prior, in conjunction with his own White House's budget proposal, NASA had set a 2028 goal. You guys tell me how feasible this all sounds. I am not shooting down the idea. I would love to be on the moon in 5 years. But this is not possible within the confines of reality and budget. It's just not going to happen. You'll see this wash away at the end of the day, like Bush's 2015 moon or Mars goal, as an unfunded, cannot be met, and we forget about thing. The problem is that it's going to detract from 2028 and Lunar Gateway, and my fear is that it will make that goal stretch further out into the future or potentially not happen, which is bad. That's the bad part of this. I mean, if we could just say, haha, Mike Pence is Mike Pence, then we could just move on. But the problem is we can't move on because Jim Bridenstine is out there right now backing the administration's play of saying, let's get this done. I mean, how serious is he? In any event, that's moving by 2024. That's what you probably heard about and saw some articles about in the news and the BOSA channel. And those are the facts. I'm not trying to bias this politically at all. If I don't care what party you are, if you stood up and said this, I would be ripping it down the same way I just did. I don't like Mike Pence as a politician, obviously, but these are the facts surrounding this goal, and it is not feasible. All right. So, last Friday morning, astronauts Nick Haig and Christina Cook performed the Spacewalk 53. The purpose of the spacewalk was to fix a solar array battery problem and to connect a second set of replacement batteries like they did the previous Friday on Spacewalk 52. Now, this video is what the tasks were. Brevorious, yes.
The crew begins the EVA by egressing the airlock and handing out the tool bags. They then hand out the new adjustable grapple bar, or AGB. They then will translate the AGB onto the external storage platform 2, where they will install it on the FHRC. The new grapple bar will serve as a spare and as an upgrade for future use. Next, EV1, Anne McLean with the red stripes on her suit.
And it wasn't Anne McLean.
Out to the worksite on P4. She will stop to retrieve an APFR, or foot restraint, that she will use during the EVA. EV2, Christina Cook, will proceed to the Sita cart and deploy a bridge between the P4 truss and the exposed pallet for the crew. She will translate to the EP and set up the worksite. Cook will start by releasing the high launch torques on all the adapter plate bolts. At this time, McLean will join her at the exposed pallet. The spacewalkers will each retrieve an adapter plate to place on their BRT, then translate to the P4 worksite.
There's a lot of acronyms in this, but there's a reason I'm showing it this way. One is to show the work that they're doing and how big it is. The other one is a point I'll make in a minute.
Once at the worksite, EV1 will ingress the APFR. The crew will work together to install an adapter plate into the empty slot.
Imagine if Kerbal was this detailed. Boy, that'd be awesome. You can EVA.
Once the adapter plate is bolted into place, the astronauts will connect cable to complete the battery pair circuit in the first slot. The crew will then get into position to install the adapter plate that EV1 has into the second empty slot.
The space station is...
They will connect cable to mate, the second battery pair for this EVA. After adjusting the foot restraint, the crew will proceed to remove and relocate an old battery. crew will install that old battery on an adapter plate, freeing up the third empty slot on this EVA.
Again, the mission of the EVA was to do this battery work.
McLean and Cook will translate together to the exposed pallet to retrieve the third and final adapter plate.
So we're going to stop it there because there's about 2 minutes left in it. But the point of this was to demonstrate that this is work that two qualified astronauts will do to maintain the station, right? Why am I not getting here? Let's exit out of here and let's represent this. So here's the problem. Obviously, Anne McLean didn't go out the door.
Wait a minute.
Anne McLean didn't go out the door. It was Christina Cook and Nick Hague. Nick Hague was EV1. He wore the suit with the red stripes. It was supposed to be crewed by Cook and McLean, and this that would have been the very what's up, Siamco? This would have been the very first all-female space flight in history. But how that was never the purpose of the flight. It was a staffing coincidence. I actually was listening this morning to commentary on this point. NASA selected two qualified astronauts to do the work, right? They never once looked at it and said, oh, there's two women on the space station. We should definitely find a way to make this happen. That was never a consideration, and it shouldn't be. Two qualified astronauts doing the work is all that should matter. Anne McLean was scrubbed from the mission for Hague following an evaluation of Spacewalk 52, where McLean and NASA ground staff determined that the large EVA suit, specifically this piece, the hard shell piece that fits right here, was too big for her, and a medium would be the correct size for safety for McLean. There's only one medium piece on the ISS, which Christina Cook wore. When that happened, and I vented about this topic to a few people last week, when that happened, people on the internet, especially and news organizations, stated this in their headlines. The mission was canceled. That's not true. There would no longer be an all-woman spacewalk. That's true. However, the mission itself, the replacement of the batteries and fixing the solar array problem, was the job. There was a change in crew assignment, but there was no cancellation of the mission. And in light of the safety issues of McLean wearing the large suit, people couldn't see past this social justice angle of the mission. They thought the mission was to facilitate an annotation in a history book. And it's just not true. If people want to pursue that as the point of the mission, they're compromising safety as an aspect of things that astronauts do in space, and that's bad. What they should have said is, man, it stinks that we won't get this all-woman spacewalk. However, I'm really glad that from a safety perspective, they decided to make the correct decision. And this is the part most people missed. At the end of the day, the removal of Anne McLean from Spacewalk 53 was Anne McLean's call. This is her tweet on Twitter because it got so bad, she felt she had to come out and defend NASA because NASA was taking a beating on social media from all sorts of people who were slamming them for not having the necessary suits available to facilitate this goal. We're going to get into the suits here. We're going to get a whole history of suits here in a second. But quote, this decision was based on my recommendation. Leaders must make tough calls, and I am fortunate to work with a team who trusts my judgment. Her judgment. Her decision. We must never accept a risk that can instead be mitigated. Safety of the crew and execution of the mission come first. And then a further tweet is, nothing has been canceled or postponed. US EVA 53 to upgrade space station power systems is on March 29th with Astro Hague and Astro Christina. EVA 54 is on 8 April to install redundant power channel for our robotic arm. That will be St. Jacques and Anne McLean. And she says, tune in, history is made every day up here. And again, as stated, the spacewalk was not canceled. The mission was completed as safely as it could be. And that's what matters. I agree. Yeah, Dr. Death says in chat, it would ruin everyone's social justice needs if it was the first all-female spacewalk leading to death. So why is this important? Why did they make this decision, right? Let's move past the world's been pretty stupid about their reaction to this. Let's talk about why this decision was made. And I've done some research on this topic, some history research. I went back in time and understood how the suits were made, and I have a lot of information for you on that. Why is too big of a suit dangerous? Because it can limit the range of motion of an astronaut's arms. If they have a plate that's sticking too far out, they can't get the arm in. Nor they might not be able to get the vertical twist in the arm that they need. It can make it very difficult to get to the oxygen controls on the front of the suit if you can't get that angle of attack with your arms down to it. And if your hands cannot go all the way into the soft portion of the suit and into the gloves completely, you may not be able to reach your fingertips. In turn, that reduces your dexterity, which makes the, as I showed in that video, the work they were doing was meticulous. They had to translate several times. It makes all of that harder. And the last thing you want to do is make maneuvering in space without a tether more difficult. Why were people more concerned about making a socio-progressive milestone happen over the safety of an astronaut? That's my question. Why were people more concerned about saying, look at the history headline versus, man, Anne McClain is a well-trained, qualified, exemplary woman. She's a colonel in the United States Army. She's flown attack helicopters. She's an astronaut. She's in the ISS. And it would be ridiculous to take an unnecessary risk with her life. The only thing worth being bothered about here is why there's only one medium on the International Space Station. And that problem has very, very deep roots. This was not a problem that manifested early last week. People only started to care about the problem, and it was for the wrong reasons. So, welcome to History Class with Fix. Suit facts. The development of the extravehicular unit, or EMU, currently used on ISS, began in the early 70s. There were no female astronauts in NASA until 1978. So that means when NASA sat down to design and then contact bidders to build the EMU, there were no female astronauts. That's a problem, I guess, in lack of foresight. But at the time, the bid didn't include female sizes because, or female proportion questions, because there weren't questions. There were no female astronauts yet. The primary life support system, the backpacks, that's called PLIS, that they used for Spacewalk 53, were made in the early 80s. Nick Hague's was made in 1980. So EV1, the red suited person, that PLIS backpack was built in 1980. It was used in 2018 to power an astronaut around the International Space Station. At the time of shuttle development, extravehicular activity was not a part of the mission because the shuttle, during its initial development, did not have EVA as a part of its mission. It was going to go up into space, put payloads into orbit, and come back down. Several designers at NASA convinced NASA that the suits were necessary, in turn EVA was necessary, as a contingency in the event that the automated closure of the bay doors would not happen. So the astronauts would don EVA suits, go out into the airlock, leave the shuttle for the cargo bay, and then hand crank the doors shut. Those of you who've seen Space Camp, that's the cranking. That's what they're talking about. But as suit development was in its infancy, NASA didn't think the shuttle needed them. It didn't happen until mid-70s when they said, hey, we probably need to fly the shuttle with space suits. EVA suits were a low priority because of all of this from a budget perspective as NASA moved into the shuttle era. Making a suit to fit all sizes of people is prohibitively expensive. Trying to make this everyone can fit into the suit we designed concept is way too expensive, given in parallel with the concept that NASA was low prioritizing the budget for the suit. They didn't make a whole lot of concessions on what size person would fit in the suit. This is why Mercury had a 5'10" height limit. Men over 5'10" couldn't be astronauts because NASA did not want to have to accommodate that size of a person in the initial suit designs. It's also the reason I was never able to pursue it. I wanted to be an astronaut, and I gave up on it when I was in my early teens because I grew to 6 foot. Given the low budget priority and the absence of female astronauts in the early design phase of EMU, NASA worked with generalities to accommodate most of the contingencies, the sizes they would run into most often to keep costs low. And at the time, there were no female astronauts. And I know this for a fact from research. NASA followed the Air Force's sizing model of 5 to 95%, meaning we want to make sure that we fit 95% of the potential population, or 95% of the Air Force pilot population at the time. As NASA moved forward with the all-male sizing model for the modular suit components, like that hard upper torso, the part that caused the problem, it created size problems for potential female astronauts as astronauts moved into the program. Eventually, the suit contractor, Hamilton Standard, proposed only two sizes to meet the 5 to 95 ratio sizing standard and left female accommodation pending. That was because they wanted to keep their own bid low. So this all comes back down to the budget. How much money can NASA spend on the suits? In 77, NASA acknowledged the shortcoming, added an extra small and an extra large to the process and design at a cost of $4.7 million. So about the 5 to 95 thing, I'm a large person. I'm well outside the 95% range, but that doesn't mean that my hands are not. That does not mean that my arms are not unusually short and fit inside that 95% threshold. It's really hard to design a suit that in all aspects fits 95% of all the potential differences in the different parts of a person. So the original decision to use 595 was also flawed. It took NASA a long time to realize this. But by 1980, female suit sizing was coming around, but it was still largely an afterthought because the overall program we've described so far had quadrupled in cost. Grand total, 18 EMUs were made. 18. 11 of them are still in use. We lost some on Challenger, we lost some on Columbia, and we've lost some from wear and tear. They must be serviced on the ground after 6 years in space or 25 spacewalks. There are 4 suits on the ISS along with some spare parts, and only one of them is medium, which means there was one suit at the end of this story that could fit either Christina Cook or Anne McLean. New suit designs have been in the works for many, many years, but there are significantly different requirements for spacewalk versus lunar use versus Martian use. And as administrators have changed, and as politicians have changed, NASA's directive has changed. And it's been difficult for NASA to zero in on what kind of suit should we make, because there is, again, if we go back and look at the 5 to 95 concept, making a one-size-fits-all suit is a bad idea. We'll run into the same problems if we don't make next-gen suits suited to each mission. And this is why things like what happened with Pence and the flip-flopping goals and Mars by 2015 and NASA having its bell rung every time someone takes office is bad, because 4 years ago they were focused on Mars and now they're focused on the moon, and they don't have a suit for either one of them done, and they definitely don't have the money for it. NASA's not being funded at a high enough rate to fill all of these mandates, especially as they change, including producing the necessary spacesuits to fit all of the potential mission profiles. This is just reality. Again, I want to see us on the moon, and I want to see us on Mars. But until there is dedicated political will that is consistent for a long time to say, we will produce a suit for lunar activity, we will produce another suit for Martian activity, we will produce another suit for low to zero G orbital activity, we're going to be relying on these 11 suits we have left. And that's insane. To pivot and turn around and say, NASA should have been prepared last week, they haven't been able to be prepared since Challenger exploded, since their budget was destroyed. They have not been in a position to facilitate making sure the suits present on the ISS fit the astronauts. And here's the other piece of information on this. Anne McLean was a large on the ground. She is a medium in space now because the physiology of people changes while in orbit. She is 2 inches taller, which means the horizontal aspect of her torso is more narrow and she is taller. That's why the medium fits her better now. You can't plan for that. You can't anticipate Anne McLean's body shape change due to microgravity. What you could have done is properly funded these goals nearly 30, 40 years ago and made sure that we have enough current suits, and quite frankly, we're already in next-gen suits. At the end of the discussion, 2 qualified astronauts went out the airlock, performed the necessary work, and Spacewalk 53 was successful. That's what we should care about. Anyway, Space Tweet. We talk about Space Tweet. Oh, Space Tweet on the screen from McLean. That was a while ago. Anyway, that's me. I try to put my rant into a factual form because the focus on the all-female side of this bothered me. It didn't bother me. It was cool. I was like, yeah, it's awesome. It's great this happening. But the array work and the batteries are more important. All right. Let's move on from yelling at NASA. India blew up a satellite. Seriously, they blew up a satellite. Like Thursday? What they did was they launched a ballistic missile interceptor from the ground to destroy one of its own satellites at a height of 300 kilometers. Now, we know that the ISS sits a little bit above that, and space is about 90 kilometers. It was a statement. They were trying to say, look what we can do. Space militarization. We can blow up your satellites. Don't mess with us. We're in India. So, 300 kilometers is bad. It produced 3,500 pieces of debris going in multiple directions simultaneously that were larger than 1 centimeter. We'll get into why 1 centimeter is significant in a second. But India didn't tell anybody. They had failed earlier this year to do this. They tried again and got it done. But the problem is twofold. One, it further escalates the militarization of space. And that's bad. We've talked about that in our discussions with Space Force in episode 2. We don't want space to become this war zone or this tactical area where people are competing from a war posture. It's just bad. But the more immediate problem is 3,500 pieces of debris. Now, they're saying 45 days until that debris goes away, right? That until that debris burns up or hits something, 45 days. 1 centimeter seems kind of small. Debris as small as 1 centimeter is a significant threat to other orbiting craft, including ISS. The picture down below, over there, which you can't see, but that little dent, that's in the cupola of the ISS right now. There's a 7 millimeter dent in one of the windows on the ISS thanks to a very small piece of space debris smacking it. Columbia also took a hit to one of its windows, and it was from a piece of paint from a Soyuz that was 1 centimeter in size, going fast enough. It chipped the window. Now, the windows in spacecraft are like 4-ply. They're really, really thick. It would take more to go through that window and the next window, the next window, the next window to cause cabin depress. But imagine if one of these pieces is going fast enough and is not as small as 1 centimeter. It's significantly larger. Its mass times its velocity gives it enough Newtonian force to break multiple windows. That's why this is really bad. Blowing up satellites for a military exercise to prove a point is dangerous on a lot of levels, but this is the most immediately dangerous thing. But it is all a part of this whole space power race that is going on right now between the U.S., the Soviet Union. Yeah, I'm old. Russia used to be the Soviet Union during the space race when I learned about it. India and China. The U.S., Russia, India, and China. They're the big players right now in this whole military domination of space. It was a geopolitical statement by India about what they can do. And the reason it was done now is because Indian elections are coming up, and Narendra Modi, he's been praised within his own country. Like, yeah, we can blow up satellites. And I imagine Americans would be generally the same when we did this. We're not innocent here. The United States has done this. The larger world has rightfully condemned this test as dangerous, both to other orbiting craft, because no consideration was generally given to it. Yes, Doc is correct in chat. Militarizing space will halt all space progress scientifically. I agree with that. The test was not as egregious as China's similar test in 2007. They did it on their third attempt, which took place at 8 100 kilometers, a much higher orbit. And it actually hit from underneath, so a lot of that debris went out. But not with enough velocity to escape Earth's gravity well. It's going to take, still has not come back down. So it's raining debris for the past 12 years back down to Earth from the Chinese satellite destructo test they did in 2007. All of this is bad. I don't know anyone who really wants humanity to explore space who says along the way we should demonstrate we can blow up each other's stuff. I don't get it. I do get it from the India elections perspective. I do get it from the India having a complex similar to what Germany's complex was at the beginning of World War II, not being treated like an equal player at the table. They're an upstart, an up-and-comer. They're new to the scene in terms of, you know, potentially a rising superpower. And this was them saying, look at us. We can do the things you can do. You should respect us. But there are other ways to do this. Put people on the moon, India. Design long-range scientific craft that blow away what other nations are doing. The scientific community will respect you, and in turn, that will translate into intelligence communities respecting your capabilities. This was unnecessary. In any event, India blew up a satellite. So, remember last Sunday, we sat down. We're going to watch Electron take off, delivering DARPA's new satellite that was proving that Kapton membrane could be a conductor for electricity and potentially communications that can make like 5G and higher internet connection from space possible, which was really cool. And then they had to cancel it. But they canceled it for a really awesome reason, because they wouldn't be able to show the video. The video station on their launch pad was malfunctioning. The rocket could have lifted off. But they said, nah, we want to capture this. And they scrubbed again Tuesday due to weather. And they scrubbed again, they flew Wednesday. So they scrubbed one more time. And I made the statement last Sunday. I was like, Let's not jerk people's chains, because Rocket Labs has a habit of slipping launches, and I'd present it to you. Well, here we go. This is that R3-D2 mission taking off.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2...
Stage one propulsion is nominal.
Beginning pitch over.
That's really pretty. It's a tiny, tiny launch facility because Electron's a small rocket, and it's a small payload.
As you just saw, we have had successful liftoff of the R3-D2 mission on Electron. Coming up soon, Electron will go through a series of mission milestones in quick succession, including main engine cutoff, or MECO, where the 9 Rutherford engines on Electron's first stage will shut down. Shortly after this, we'll see stage 1 separation, followed by ignition of the vacuum-optimized Rutherford engine on Electron's second stage.
So they do something similar
following
to SpaceX.
Following second stage ignition, Electron's
fairing will
separate,
of their main engine.
Revealing the payload
there's
in preparation
called the Rutherford,
for deployment approximately 50 minutes.
Atmosphere-optimized and a vacuum-optimized engine, and there's S2 has a vacuum-optimized engine of the Rutherford on it. That's really pretty above the cloud line.
Max-Q.
And there's Max-Q of the launch, which again is maximum dynamic pressure on the vehicle, the maximum amount of physical pressure it feels during its liftoff.
1 minute remaining.
So the Electron and the Rocket Lab liftoffs take place on a small island in the New Zealand chain.
Stage one propulsion still
and
nominal.
It sits on the end of a peninsula. It's really, I mean, I'd like to get in a boat and go out there and watch it, but
Chatham Station.
The clearance area is way too big, and it's fairly remote. And it's interesting that they're launching rockets from such a remote location. But at the end of the day,
CO2 successful.
Really cool.
Engines throttle down, 20 seconds remaining.
So their S1 SEP is coming up.
Entering burnout detect mode.
So if you remember, when we looked at the R3D2 payload, it had like this spherical woven material inside of it, and the idea is when it gets up there, it's going to blossom almost like
stage
a flower,
one, Miko.
And that Kapton's going to expand.
Stage there's your suppression succeeded.
S1 SEP, S2 burn.
Mission on stage 2, propulsion is nominal.
Nah, thing heat up. But it's a really cool design.
Right down the center line.
You go back on your cradle. No one's talking to you right now, Vector. We'll take this to fairing step. If they have a camera on the front side that shows it.
Fairing jettison.
Or if they catch it in their camera, they might. There it went.
And there
right
you
there.
Have it. Confirmation that Electron's main engines have shut down.
There's
as
your
planned.
Fairing step. That's a clamshell.
We've had stage 1 separation, and the stage 2 engine has successfully ignited. Electron is now carrying on to orbit.
So that was the Electron orbit that we all missed because they just couldn't nail down the right the window for it. But that's the launch. Wanted to bring it to you because we had decided to watch it together. Simply put, it had slipped too many times, and I didn't want to keep pulling you guys onto the stream for another launch to just be scrubbed. So let's move on to Mango's question from... Vector is not cooperating. He's like, no, I'm not staying on my charger. Hey, Vector, find your charger. Thank you, buddy. Put him on the charger twice, and he's like, nope, rolling right off. I'm not listening to you. But as we were playing Satisfactory during its launch week, the topic of space elevators came up a few times, but I was watching Mango stream as she built it, and she effectively said, how do they work? What's a space elevator? I did some research, and I can speak to it, but this video encapsulates it. It's on YouTube. It's by a site called Seeker, who he still isn't listening. You just don't want to stay on there, right, do you? Just want to keep walking around? It's by a site called Seeker. I've linked it in the video, in the slide presentation, but it eloquently explains exactly what's a space elevator, and it pretty much sums up what it's doing at Satisfactory as well.
A space elevator is one of those ideas that sounds ultra crazy at first, but when you learn more about it, it still sounds absolutely crazy, but you can see the upsides. It's exactly what it sounds like, a giant elevator that you get in down here on Earth and you step off of in freaking space. You'd need an anchor on Earth, which would serve as the loading station for the elevator car, a tether stretching into space for the car to travel along, and a counterweight way out in space to keep the tether taut. Designs vary, but it looks like the counterweight could have to be as far as 100,000 kilometers above the Earth, more than a quarter the distance to the moon.
Bear in mind,
sounds nuts,
SLS
but for some, it's not just a pie-in-the-sky idea.
Kilometers.
It's something they're actively working towards. In September of 2018, researchers from Shizuoka University in Japan launched an experiment to the ISS to test the practicality of one aspect of a space elevator. The experiment involves two tiny cube satellites connected by 10 meters of cable, with a small container moving along the cable with a motor. It's a far cry from a full-fledged space elevator, but the goal was to show that locomotion along a cable in space was possible. The experiment is in collaboration with the construction firm Obayashi, which 6 years prior announced plans to build a space elevator by 2050. They're not the only ones toying with the idea. China intends to build one by 2045, and NASA has commissioned studies to look into how feasible the idea is. But hold up, why all the fuss about space elevators to begin with? What's wrong with good old chemical-powered rockets? Well, while we have rocket technology right now to lift payloads and people into space, it's extremely costly. According to SpaceX, it costs roughly $2,700 to put 1 kilogram of cargo into low Earth orbit. An elevator to space would be a massive construction project. Obayashi estimates it would cost $90 billion to build. But once built, by one estimate, it could cost as little as $200 to get 1 kilogram into space.
That's a huge difference.
Meaning I would only need $13,000 to get off this planet as opposed to $175,000. A space elevator would open up so many possibilities, like building and launching ships in orbit. Hello, Starfleet. It could make trips to Mars less fuel intensive because a ship could plummet towards Earth like an Olympic high diver, using Earth's gravity to boost it onto the red planet. Tourists could make trips up regularly, just get in, listen to Girl from Ipanema, make awkward small talk for a few thousand kilometers, and then get the selfie of a lifetime. flat earthers could finally see what we have been trying to explain to them all along. There's literally no reason not to do this, except that we can't do it yet.
Agreed.
Sure, we could build many of the components with the materials that we have today, like the anchor on Earth, the counterweight out in space, and the elevator car itself. But the actual tether that holds the whole thing together that makes it a space elevator is an extreme challenge.
Yes.
As of today, there's no material strong enough and light enough to stretch 100,000 kilometers into space. That's almost 2.5 times the Earth's circumference. The material has to be resistant to weather, radiation, and orbital debris. The closest thing to that right now are carbon nanotubes, which can be 100 times stronger than steel, but they're difficult to make longer than a few centimeters, which is about 100,000 kilometers short of the goal. Still, Japanese scientists are committed to building a lift to the heavens, and the first stop will be proving an elevator car can travel along a 10-meter cable in space. If you like this video, subscribe, because where else are you going to learn about more cool nanocarbon structures like short sites?
Solid website if you have science questions that cover more things than just science.
Carbon nanotubes were discovered by a Japanese researcher, and their expertise is part of why they are more dedicated to building a space elevator than most other countries. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time on Seeker.
Pretty solid. But that is what a space elevator is. The big problem with space elevators, from where I sit, is not, again, not building the platform or maintaining it. Maintaining it at 100,000 kilometers is a trick. Again, it's one quarter of the way to the moon. But that's not the hard part, nor is building the ground station. It is the cable. And keeping the cable taut between the ground anchor and the space side of the anchor. But the big benefit is, as was stated, we could cut the cost of cargo or people to space. We could launch and construct in space versus the costly model of doing it on the planet. The problem is building it. But it, to a degree, he was right. Hello, Starfleet. Because Star Trek does this to a degree. Their orbital platforms, all the space docks and orbital construction yards, they're showing that technology from that perspective because it would be the evolution beyond space elevators. That building in 0G is less expensive than building in 1G. Anyway, that is space elevators to a degree, or in a nutshell, and how they work. And hopefully Mango and whoever else is playing Satisfactory got their question answered, because that's what Satisfactory is doing too. You're taking cargo from the planet you're on, shipping it up that cable to a pickup point in orbit so that the Fix-It Corporation can take it away and, you know, exploit the planet better. This is the next... Look, buddy, you've got to calm down. You're going to have to, like, sit on the floor or something because you're making too much noise. Stay down there. He seriously does not want to listen right now. He is just all about moving around. So, we talked earlier tonight about SLS Orion changing, pivoting, all the stuff that's gone wrong in terms, in my opinion, in the last few weeks with the way NASA and the White House has been messaging around space. So we all know a couple weeks ago, I think we talked about it again during episode 2, that Jim Bridenstine, the NASA administrator, sat in front of the Senate Commerce Committee pretty much the day that the White House budget proposal was released and suggested that NASA would seek commercial partners in lieu of SLS, the Space Launch System, being ready by June 2020. Again, SLS was supposed to fly in 2017 and it has not. So now, well, earlier this week, NASA pivoted back to using SLS. There's been a big PR push to say, we'll be ready for Exploration Mission 1, which is the unmanned mission that will take Orion with the European Service Module and the wet stage necessary to make the trip into orbit to go around the moon and come back. SLS Block 1B is still proposed for defunding by the White House in the 2020 budget proposal, which is in direct opposition to the moon by 2024 goal. Block 1B would be necessary to carry Orion, European Service Module, and the wet stage to orbit. I think we did this in episode 3. We talked about, no, 2. We talked about how impossible using commercial rockets for EM1 was, and how dangerous it was for a potential EM2 because of the inability of Orion to dock in orbit with any other manned craft currently available. So, everybody took the pivot back to SLS as a return to sanity, right? That's NASA came to its senses. We're not gonna launch untested rockets with people on board in EM2. Or, you know, so we thought. Today, there was another town hall. And Bridenstine laid out a scenario where Orion, and I assume ESM, could directly inject into lunar orbit using Falcon Heavy with an engine built by ULA, the cryogenic propulsion stage. One, you'd have to get those two companies to play nice together, and they currently don't. Elon Musk antagonizes ULA on the internet all the time, basically saying, haha, look what we can do, you guys can't get off the ground, but like, with respect to Starliner. But it also you need to bear in mind that this was explained as a way to facilitate the moon 2024 goal. Bridenstine was explicitly talking to Pence's speech. He was saying, sure, I see a scenario in which we could get astronauts to the lunar south pole by 2024 by launching Orion on a Falcon Heavy using ULA's cryogenic propulsion stage as the wet stage. And again, assume with the ESM. Yep. I don't have that much more, Leech. You guys competed for the tributes. I think I will now get all of my NASA news from you. Buzz, I appreciate that. I put a lot of work and research into this show each week with the hope that a few people get information out of it. I also encourage those of you who know where the YouTube channel is, button down below, and I try to present this in a way that parents may be able to present it to kids. I don't care if it's reused.
Remember to clonk that follow 7
p.m.
button.
Every Monday, yes sir, Eastern Standard Time. But I will take my break, Leech, I promise, because I'm almost done actually. But to the point is that Bridenstine was speaking directly to this 2024 goal. There is this repeating point I keep trying to make, and I've made it several times, both in the discussion of flip-flopping goals from a long-term administrative perspective with the spacesuits to 2028 to 2024. Now we're talking about, do we take SLS as the vehicle that's going to make Gateway happen? Because you must have the ESM for Gateway. You may not need it in this scenario of getting Orion plus the cryogenic stage to the moon. But where's the lander for that can dock with Orion? Because Gateway is supposed to facilitate the reusable lander scenario to go down to the moon and come up. So all this flip-flopping of goals, and I believe Bridenstine screwed up today because he's saying, oh yeah, we're all behind that 2024 goal. That means they're going to put money toward it. How much money, I don't know. But it's money they don't have. They don't have the money to placate the vice president, let alone pursue the goal. So here's where we stand at the end of all of this. 2028 Orion ESM wet stage construction of Lunar Gateway, if that is where they still go, has to be done on SLS, and NASA intends to do it on SLS. They actually have said, we think we can be in a position to deliver SLS by next summer. I still think that's pie in the sky, but we'll see. Do a static fire test sometime in the next 9 months and we'll talk. But then there's this other commercial angle again, which directly plays into the Pence saying, well, if one contractor can't get it done, use another one part we talked about earlier, where Bridenstine thinks they can get lunar inject done on a Falcon Heavy. And I that's feasible. But let's go back to episode 2 where we talked about Orion's a 5-meter payload. And Falcon Heavy's a 3.3-meter fairing. Where's the interstage adapter for that? We talked about it not being feasible to engineer all of that by 2020 and have it ready to take EM1 up. Now, we are also going to have to talk about, is it feasible to have that all done by 2024? It's more feasible, but still, can it be done? I think SpaceX could probably build it. I don't think NASA can keep up with that pace, and I still don't think ULA plays ball with either one of them if SpaceX is involved. Adapter Island. Yeah, that's where we go get all of the adapters, actually, in Kerbal. Adapter Island. That probably answers Doc's question from earlier, too. I think I might run over Vector. So let me pick him back up because he like drove behind me in protest. Stay there, buddy. He's like Eddie embodied right there, this little robot on my desk. So at the end of the day, I mean, I keep track of what goes on in these hearings and these speeches because it sends messages about where NASA's going, but I still think 2028 is the only feasible goal. I think Lunar Gate was the only way to do it because it's got engineering work behind it. We'll see. But stay tuned because I'm sure by next week, Brian Stein will flip-flop two more times on the position of NASA with respect to both goals. We'll see. Beresheet. Oh, you can't find the fly-by-wire module I'm using. Okay, it's called MechJeb 2. It might not be in CCAN. I could probably get you a link to it. Starship all the way. Yeah. Mars plans now include it, to be fair. NASA has, in some of these meetings in the past week, included, and it's actually a faux pas from the administration and from NASA to suggest that their primary planning goal is to use a commercial rocket. But the Mars mission planning that has been discussed in the past week highlights Starship as its primary vehicle. While Riot brought that up in chat, yeah. We'll see if that also takes shape. That was also mentioned today. So, for those of you unfamiliar, BOSA's baby, the very first launch we watched, was the Falcon 9 Block 5 Nusantara Satu mission, which put an Indonesian communication satellite in space. But the cool payload, as in a ship that will make the trip to and from Mars, says Buzz in chat. Yes, if you're not familiar with Starship is the Interplanetary Transportation System, ITS system, that SpaceX is designing. They're actually doing a static fire test of the upper stage this week at Boca Chica. But it's a big rocket. Actually, you know what? Let's go ahead and... Because he asked, we haven't started the Beresheet thing yet. Let's go and have a look at that. Let's go open last week's slide deck so that you can see it. So... this will give you an idea. This guy right here, that's Falcon Heavy. This guy right here, that's Starship. BFR is the name for its first stage. Starship is the name for its second stage. It actually has another name now, Falcon Super Heavy. But it's big. And to give you an idea, that's 9 meter diameter craft. That's a big rocket. I actually like the fact that I knew exactly where my slide decks that was. But it is designed for the purpose right now. SpaceX has pivoted to making... how big is it compared to the Saturn V? Another good question. Let's do that. I'll ask all the questions. Starship versus SATURN-5. So I know someone's done this. There you go. There's Saturn V. There's Starship. There's Falcon 9. Make this a little bit easier to see here. There you go. Not as powerful as Saturn V, but also doesn't need to be as powerful as Saturn V. Legos. Says Leech, I still have the Saturn V Lego sitting in a box. I'm actually waiting until I find like a more permanent place to live before I build it because I don't want to break it in transit. That's literally the goal. Make it! I wanna! Probably has better computers in it too. The Crew Dragon pod has touch screens in it, which is good and bad. It's good for the presentation of the controls in any language to support international operations, but there is something to be said for knobs and switches from a position of dexterity. But in any event, that's the comparison. You want to know anything else about BFR, ITS, Starship, or Falcon Heavy, Super Heavy before we move on? Because I'm more than happy to answer the questions. Yeah, it's 1,969 pieces. Anybody know why it's 1,969 pieces, the Saturn V Lego? Well, you might know, Leech. Should be more. 1969 is the year you land on the moon. All right, but back to, unless there's more questions on Starship, we'll go back to Beresheet. Okay, so recapsulating where we were. Beresheet was a payload, a secondary payload on the very first launch we all watched together, which was the Nusantara Satu Falcon 9 launch back in late February. And it's a really cool thing. It's this... company, it's a commercial company called Space IL, They are an Israeli company, and they are the first commercial company to land or to attempt to land anything on the moon. They were originally a participant in Google Lunar X Prize. The Lunar X Foundation has now told them that if they make the landing, they'll get a payout. I think it's like $1 million payout from the foundation. But let's start with where it is. And I know you guys love this. There's the Earth. There's all the junk around the Earth. Here's Beresheet. She's really far out there now. To put it in perspective, that is where Beresheet currently is in the orbit. Her apogee is actually further away. Her perigee is currently 169. Yeah, I was right. Apogee. Her perigee is 169 kilometers. Her apogee is 407,000 kilometers. So the upper point of the ellipse, and she's approaching it. This is she travels in a counterclockwise direction. So this is her current position. The moon is actually inside of this ellipse, which means she's ready for an inject burn, which should be coming up soon, which means she's going to make an inject burn to create a lunar orbit, and then she's going to shrink that orbit and shrink that orbit and shrink that orbit and then attempt to land on the moon. But this was a really cool video. I'm going to mute it because it's got a lot of static in it, but this was Beresheet grabbing sunrise as she flies away from Earth. I thought that was awesome. So I would say yesterday was supposed to be the time frame that was estimated for the first burn for injection, but remember she had a computer glitch on her first burn at periapsis. I always throw the terms backwards even though I know them in my head. So, hey, direct connection, Discord connection last time, no big deal. But anyway, she had a computer glitch, which means she had to make one more short revolution in her initial elliptical orbit. So she's behind by a few days. They don't produce a chart of where she is with relation to the moon, and I can't make the Jet Propulsion Laboratory show me where the moon is in that, because it just tracks Earth orbiting objects, which technically Beresheet still is. So sometime in the next, I would imagine, few days, we should start hearing news about Beresheet getting close to making or has made that lunar inject burn to create the first larger orbit. And then they'll start to scale down that orbit in terms of its altitude around the moon, and then talk about landing. And I really can't wait to show the landing attempt. And the reason I have more confidence than I would have in say a Martian landing, there's no atmosphere. It's a lot easier to land on the moon than it is on Mars. So this is for Dustin. Dustin's favorite mission, Hayabusa 2, makes an impression this week. This is the week that Hayabusa 2 will blow a hole into Ryugu. This is for science, and we'll definitely have more information on it next week. Hayabusa 2 is an asteroid sample return mission operated by JAXA, the Japanese Space Agency. It follows the original Hayabusa mission, which returned asteroid samples in 2010. Hayabusa 2 was launched 3 December 2014, rendezvoused with Ryugu on 27 June of last year. It is in the process of surveying. It has landed once on it already. We've seen some pretty spectacular video of this really granular material that is making up the surface of Ryugu. And it is going to take its sample. It's going to blast a hole in this asteroid sometime this week, take its deeper core sample, and then it's going to depart the asteroid later this year, and we won't see it home until December of basically a year later. It'll leave December this year. We'll get it back home, or get the samples back home. I'm not sure how Hayabusa 2 ends yet. We'll research that more as the time comes, but we'll get the samples back at least by December 2020. Gary, there's nothing scary about that, man. That's awesome. All right, upcoming launches. Two launches this week. I cannot stream due to work because the time. Soyuz 2.1A is the Progress MS-11 mission. It is a resupply mission. It is at 7:01 in the morning on the 4th, which is Thursday. And if you want to stream it, Watch it. Obviously, check the BOSA channel in the Discord because those launch notifications and links go up automatically there. It's really nice, so I don't have to post them when I can't show the stream. Same day, Soyuz STB frigate is launching a satellite. That is a Ariane Soyuz joint mission from French Guiana. That launches at 12:30 p.m. Eastern time. Obviously, I can't stream that one as well. I'll still be at work. The one we care about. The next big deal space stream for BOSA is this Sunday. Falcon Heavy. The first Block 5 Falcon Heavy. And the second time Falcon Heavy has ever launched. It'll be its first commercial payload. It is Arabsat 6A. 6:36 is liftoff time right now. We will start the stream somewhere between 5:30 and 6, depending on when NASA announces a go live. I imagine this is a high profile launch. They're probably going to go live early, just like they did for DM1. We will stream this. I'm on call, but barring on call and stuff blowing up at work, I will stream this. And right now I'm anticipating just a tentative, hey, 6-ish is when we're going to go live, but I will update that as NASA provides information on their stream. There is a static fire test tomorrow. There is now published road closure guidance for that static fire test of Falcon Heavy for tomorrow. NASA has said, I think from noon to 8 is the window for it, but road closures start at 7:30 on the Space Coast. So they're going to definitely try to do their static fire Falcon Heavy tomorrow. The only caveat to the launch on top of my own work schedule is currently, and bear in mind we're 6 days away, there's a 30% chance of rain on Sunday. I imagine if it rains, they don't launch it. Going back to Apollo 12, the entire platform on the command module was thrown haywire because that rocket was hit by two different bolts of lightning. So rain may turn to thunderstorm predictions. I still doubt that they launch it in the rain. I would imagine they would slip that if it's rainy. If they slip it to Monday, we'll watch it in lieu of this show Monday night, and then we'll push course correction probably Tuesday or Wednesday next week. I'll be ready for a show on Monday because rocket launches are what they are. They slip all the time. But right now, Sunday, 6-ish p.m. Eastern time, we will attempt to show Falcon Heavy if it is indeed launching then. It looks like right now they're on track for that. And then the next one, beyond that, so not until 7 days later is there a viewable launch, and that's Pegasus XL, the Ionosphere Connection Explorer, or ICON, and that launches at 8 p.m. Eastern time on April 14th. That is streamable. We will stream that one, assuming it also does not slip. Don't forget, we got a website where I post all the videos and sometimes write things. If you find this show of value, if you find it informative, again, I just plug this once a week. Patreon's there. Sometimes. Sometimes, when I feel like writing something. I really wanted to present the information that I presented tonight here. I almost wrote it up, but I decided not to. But I wanted to do it here with the community live. But I have the Patreon button below. I'm never going to pursue being a partner. And the Patreon stuff helps me offset. I am a patron of other space content providers so that I can in turn come back here and present it to you in this show. It helps me offset some of the costs of giveaways and everything else. Speaking of giveaways, we're going to do one. We got enough people in chat. Your support via Patreon helps me offset those costs and gives me access to not only the graphics and some of the videos that we show here, but also gives me access to NASA Space Flight, which is a place I go to do a lot of research because there's a lot of information there that is not on the NASA website. So helps me maintain everything. And those of you who are patrons, I appreciate it. Questions. So let's start with that. We're going to do two things here. One, if you have questions, now's the time to ask them. But don't forget, where are you?
I have this thing over here. I've got to get it. I got to stretch.
So giveaway time. Because we have lots of people watching live, even though they're lurking and not asking questions. We have these two. Again, you have, come back here. You guys can see it. You've got the space shuttle button, which has got a pin back. You have the Apollo anniversary button. Those are handcrafted by a creator on Etsy, which has a traditional clip pin back. And then the ones everyone wants. We have the waiting for addresses from two people who have won. We have the pull to eject keychain pull, which is yellow. You can't really see it that well because of chroma key. But it says pull to eject. And then you have the remove before flight pull. And these all have key rings on them. You can send theirs to me. No. People have to just give me the address and I'll send them. In any event, we'll fire that off. It's 100 tributes to get in. You do not have to be anything. Just you're watching. There's no minimum hours. There is no anything. Anyone can enter. It is exclamation point raffle. Get in. Go for it. As far as everything else, questions, don't forget, you guys can submit topics while I'm asking right now for next week's show. You can submit topics in BOSA, channel of Discord. You can submit them on Twitter, but I'm less likely to remember them on Twitter because I don't have a way of bookmarking tweets. So you guys come up with things you want to talk about. I do not have any questions pending for next week in terms of what we're going to present on the show, so it will be all news again. But if you have something you want to know about, ask away. So I went to the flight museum and they had boxers with remove before flight on them. Thank you very much, Buzz. That's awesome. Leech, Riot, Dr. Death are in for the raffle. Three people who have been here for almost everything I've ever done space-wise. I mean, most of you have been. Giveaway will end in 1 minute. Again, it's exclamation point raffle. You do not need to feel like just because you're a lurker or don't comment at all ever, you don't enter, please. I got enough things to give away. We're not going to get new giveaways until we give away this stuff. You would have bought them, but you didn't have the money. Interesting date night, man. While this is counting down, we're going to talk about schedule real quick for the rest of the week. I do start my on-call rotation with work on Thursday, which sucks. But if you look at the schedule channel right now, you'll see that nothing tomorrow. I'm going to a concert. It's my Christmas present on Wednesday. We're going to see two cellos, me and Ash. Thursday, 7 p.m., we're going to continue station design in KSP. We have to build the solar arrays, which is going to be an interesting payload creation. 10 seconds on the giveaway. And then Friday, I want to play Risk of Rain. I would like to play it with community members. If you have Risk of Rain 2, Leech, which one do you want, Leech? It was pretty much going to, you had a 30 or 66% chance to win. But Ryan's like, hell yeah! Doc says, Rick, Doc, you got something today. What can you get again? You can get either the remove before flight pull, the pull to eject pull, which is yellow letters on black background, or how would I put them? Over here. I am selfish, sue me. Oh yeah, you were supposed to enter exclamation point raffle, but it's over now. I'm not going to sing an 80s song. You can get that button, which is the Apollo button. Celebrating the era of Apollo, where you get the smaller celebrating the era of the shuttle button. Remove before flight. You got it. First one of those gone. So we have three remove before flights left, two pull to eject left, and only one of the buttons is claimed. Alrighty, so... Oh, you're welcome. Thanks for hanging out. Making the stream works better when people are present, always. So DM me an address, Leech, and I'll get it off to you. When I do usually do one run a month to mail giveaways just because I hate going to the post office. So I'll get them out as soon as everyone else gives me an address. But I was saying Friday night, if you have Risk of Rain 2, it's a fun game. Doc and I are really good at it at this point, just getting fairly deep into the game. But if you have it, you want to play, assuming that work cooperates, there's a major go live this Friday, which is why I'm really tentative with the on-call this week. It shouldn't affect me, but there's a chance it will. So I'm kind of, we'll see how Friday goes with respect to playing. And then after that, Sunday, don't forget, we will have Falcon Heavy, 6-ish for stream start, Arabsat 6A launch. Launch currently scheduled for 6:36, so keep my eye on the weather. I will post updates as I see them in terms of probability, just so you guys have a better idea. I've been trying to do that with the Falcon 9 launches because they tend to publish that information. Six is bish. But anyway, guys, thank you very much for being here. A little bit shorter than last week, and as you guys know, I don't tend to play games the same night I do the show, but I do have something really cool here. I did this. This quote is awesome.
try today and be less wrong tomorrow, which feels absolutely fundamental to the business of being alive. And instead, actually, the cultural yardstick that we hold ourselves accountable to, or we are told to hold ourselves and, more importantly, one another to, is be right at all times, and if you are even momentarily wrong, death to you. Which is literally the death of all intellectual endeavour, but also cultural endeavour, social endeavour, gender, fluidity, progress of any nature. If you will be pilloried for being wrong, that is the death of progress. Yeah.
Indeed. The reason I said that today is because I've gotten into discussions recently in educational streams where people have been more focused on being right than on recognizing mistakes and learning from them as a community. And that said, I make mistakes in this show. If you see one, correct me on the spot. If you see one after, let me know. And I will also correct things, because more important as a community that we consume correct information, and we're not going to be right all the time. And that's good, because you learn the most from the mistakes you make. So please, be less wrong tomorrow. And you guys have a good night. And I will see you Thursday night, if not sooner, when we do some more KSP. Doc, you can hit me up in Discord after the show if you have any more questions, or just we can talk in Discord. But it's okay to be bad at things, because every time you try, you get better. Unless you're Dustin and it's Sekiro. You guys have a good night. Again, thank you for hanging out. I appreciate the fact that you guys show up and enjoy this show. And we will be back next Monday night with another course correction. We'll be back Sunday night with Falcon Heavy launch, and Thursday night with KSP Olympus Station building. And that's on YouTube now. Thanks, indeed. ISS Station building will continue with solar and radiator array construction and deployment. We'll see you then. You guys have a good night. I didn't even look. Ulti. Let's go host Ulti. How about that? Get you over to Ulti in a second. Have a great night, guys.